Hi everyone, thank you for being here. I'm Wilfred Rosé and we'll talk today about how to improve your SQL workload with observability. So you can find me on GitHub with my first name and last name. And I am actually an engineering manager at OVH. If you don't know it, OVH is a French European cloud provider. We want to be a simple multi-local. So multi-local is about being close to our customer, accessible, predictable. You won't get any surprise at the end of the month with the bill. Reversible, it's really important with your data, and transparent. We do what we say, and we say what we do. OVH is present all around the world, and we have a lot of server ready to host you. And if I am here today is to talk about SQL because I don't know if you are aware, but everyone use SQL. Whether it be directly or indirectly, and it's a good thing. But with this reputation comes how can I say it? This was my life when I first joined OVH, and this is our developer coming at our desk every day, at every hour, every time to ask questions about their databases, their query, schema, workload, etc. And as you can imagine, this is not efficient neither for them or for us. So I was thinking that we can improve this, and what comes to mind is we need observability. And when it comes to observability, there is several types of observabilities, and the first one is none, no observability at all. And I am sure that someone in the room use this type of observability at least once in his life, in his, her life, and probably still using it. But this is not what we want, and we need to evolve for the better. And we might switch to ugly observability with an handy terminal to run some bash script, bash command, tail, top, htop, but this doesn't scale. If you have 60,000 of cluster databases, you will eventually won't be able to follow what's going on. And that's why we need to improve. And in my opinion, a good observability looks like this with nice dashboard. This is Grafana. And why not using it? So to give you a bit of context, at OVH, my team and I only have 24 hours a day. So basically, just like you. When we have started this project, we were two. We are now four, and we are looking to grow the team. And all of our databases represent 20 terabytes on disks. We have 60 clusters split in two information systems with 400 databases and 3,000 applications. And with this perimeter, we want to be able to see everything and to have all the answers for our developers. And we want to be able to isolate one particular query. Maybe this slow query. Maybe someone has an idea why this query is slow. We get back to this at the end, but how can we fix this query if we are not able to to track it. And that's the point. We want to improve our workload, so we need to be able to see what's going on at each minute of the day. Our infrastructure looks like this. We are running in HA cluster, whether it be Postgres or MySQL, and we have a primary node which will receive the read-write query, select, insert, update, delete. We also expose a read-only endpoint which will receive only the select. We use replication, and we have a dedicated node used to take consistent snapshot using ZFS, and we restore those snapshots to create a development environment for our developer, so they can test their application, new feature with real data, heavy data. And with this infrastructure and only two people and no observability, that's not a surprise that we were crumbling under the request, because we were the bottleneck of the whole process. Each developer needs to pass by us to get the answer to their question. Why my query is slow? Can I get an alter, etc.? So we need to evolve. We need to improve this process. That's why we want to make our observability easier, better, faster, and stronger. And doing so, we have some requirement. We want to give our developer as much as possible so they can be autonomous. We want to be able to extract meaningful KPIs so we see where we are headed. And we want to encourage ownership and productivity. To do so, we have some prerequisites. We don't want to extend our perimeter, so we need to rely on others to build our new observability. We need to do so for the logs, the metrics, and the UI. I don't want to end up having to manage a logs platform or metrics platform. Maybe it's simple, but I don't want to. I need to be able to focus on my clusters, on my DBMS. And finally, we want to be able to use and contribute to open source, so we are not locked in some manner. At OVH, we have two services, two platforms. One is OVH Logs, which is responsible, which is a log platform. You push your logs and you can use them. And we have the same OVH Metrics, which is the same for the metrics. Let's focus on logs. But observability is kind of a troll subject, and I want to stress the point that observability is not about how to collect your data, but what to do with it. We can debate on whether Logstash is better than someone else, something else. That's not the point. So let's focus. First, we need to make sure that everything is correctly configured. At OVH, we have two types of cluster. We have Postgres and MySQL, MariaDB. So for Postgres, we need to define log line prefix to have all the information that we need. And we want also to enable the slow query. At OVH, we are running on bare metal server. So we have decided with experience that a query that runs for more than 1 second should be considered as slow. So that's what we've done. We have defined our log length prefix and the duration for our slow query. And we can do the same thing for MySQL. We enable the performance schema, and we enable the slow query and define that a slow query is a query that runs for more than 1 second. With this, we can start giving meaning to our logs. And that's what we want to do. And to do so, we are relying on two open source tools. The first one, you might know it, is PgBadger. You feed it your logs, and it produces a report. And you can do the same thing with Percona Toolkit, PT Query Digest, that will parse the slow log and produce a meaningful report. And with these simple first steps, we have made our first improvement. So basically, what we have done is to extract the logs, put it on a server, and run every day PgBadger or PT Query Digest to generate a report for each and every cluster and expose directly those reports to our internal customer, our colleagues. So with this, our developer doesn't need to ask us what's going on. They can directly have a look to the report. And by doing so, we generate those reports in the morning. So what you can do when you arrive at work, grab a coffee, go through the report, and see if you need to fix something. If you don't know PgBadger, here is an example of the output. You have all information, the number of query, the stats, the query peak, and so on. But because we have so many logs, so many clusters, this doesn't suit our use case, and we will see right after how we can make an improvement on this step, because logs are only useful and report if you can read them. And as DBA, we want to avoid the need to connect directly to our cluster to use grep, less, cat, and so on. So starting from this point, we will evolve again. Now, what we want is to extract our log, send it to a Logstash cluster that will be responsible for parsing our logs and extract meaningful information and store them in Elasticsearch indexes. And the Logstash cluster and Elasticsearch indexes are not in our perimeter. This is given from our OVH log platform. So we don't extend our perimeter, and that's nice. And that scale because each server is responsible to send its log to a specific endpoint. Logstash rely on Grok to extract meaningful information from a log line, and it supports multi-line logs. So you can reconstruct a meaningful document from a log that's 2 lines, 3 lines, or more. In this example, we have our first line, which is a log line, and we want to extract the username and the source IP. And we can do so using regex to build a nice JSON document that will be stored in our Elasticsearch index. Next, we want to define how to send our logs to our Logstash. So we can use whatever we want. In our case, we are using Filebit or syslog, and you should choose what is easy to set up for your use case. Maybe you only need Filebit, maybe you only need syslog. How and why did we choose to use both? That is that for all files already handled by syslog, we just add the destination and send the log with syslog. And for the log files that aren't managed by syslog, we ship them with Filebit. This is easy. No, nothing complicated here. So for Filebit, the configuration is quite easy. You configure your destination, our Logstash cluster, and you define which file to harvest and to send. You can do the same thing for syslog by defining a destination, our Logstash cluster, and use this destination on a source source log in your syslog configuration. With this new setup, we have made our second improvement, and now each server, each cluster, sends its log to OVHLog, our log platform. And with our log platform comes Graylog, which is a UI that we can use to browse our logs, and that's what we do. And we expose this UI to our developer, so now they have the reporting, and they have their log live, because each time there is a new line added to a file, it's shipped automatically to our Logstash cluster where it is passed and stored in our Elasticsearch index and directly accessible for our developers. So now they have an instant view to their workload. And with Graylog, we are able to browse our log. So obviously, we won't see our logs. But you can also build a dashboard to see that the number of documents per databases. This is quite important because if you want to filter, for example, or on the error level, you can see that, for example, the pink databases is generating more error than the other database. But with our setup, we lost the source IP because, as I was saying, we have a HA cluster, and to do so, we are using a load balancer and a connection pooler. The load balancer and the connection pooler are installed on the same server as the DBMS. And by doing so, what we see in the log is the IP of the connection pooler. So basically, in the log, we see the address of the server and not the source IP of the client. This makes the PGHBF, for example, less useful because you cannot apply restriction from on the source IP. It's harder to track bad queries because you know the databases, you know the users, but you don't know from where the query happens. So it's harder to find this information. And for security audit, obviously, it's a little bit harder. You probably know it. There is a protocol named proxy protocol, which solve this problem. And we want to help. We have started a thread on PostgreSQL Hacker, and we have made a pull request on PGBadger to implement the support of proxy protocol directly in Postgres and in PGBouncer. So if you want to give us a hand, feel free to help. So now we have our logs, we have our reports, we are missing the metrics. So let's have a look on our metrics. And again, the same thing that we said for the logs, it's also true for the metrics. I don't want to fight whether Prometheus is better than OpenTSDB of your homemade script to scrap the metrics of your database. This is not the important fact here. What is important is what to do with those metrics as soon as you have them. So to collect them, you have a lot of solutions. Please don't use homemade script to collect your CPU usage or your logs usage. There is a lot of solution out there. You can use CollectL, CollectG, StatsD, which are old and well tested, or you can turn to Telegraphs or Prometheus or whatever. In our case, we have chosen to use Telegraph because it provides everything that we need and works in push method. So Telegraph will send the log to the backend, to OVH metrics. If we have used Prometheus, we will have needed to add some other thing to scrap those metrics and then send it to our OVH metrics. So that's why we have used Telegraph to collect everything related to system, DBMS and Telegraph, if there is a corner case for you, you can use the exec plugin to execute your homemade script. And there is a lot of more plugin available on their GitHub. So let's have a look to the configuration. It's quite simple. You define the frequency, you define the output. So in our case, it's OVHlog, user, password, and then you enable all plugins that you need. So if you want, in this specific case, to collect PostgreSQL metric, you enable the PostgreSQL plugin, configure it with user and password to use and where to connect, and that's it. Now, with this new improvement, all server, all cluster are responsible to send their metrics to our metrics platform. And with the metrics platform comes Grafana. So again, we don't have to extend our perimeter. And with our metric, with Grafana that we expose to our developers, we have built some dashboard to expose them information. So in this case, we are using on all our dashboard, templated dashboard, so it can select, so I am in France, in Canada, I'm working, I want to have the information to the cluster number 12, and I want to see this specific host, and the dashboard will update according to what you have selected. So here we have all system-related metrics, load, CPU usage, memory, disk usage. We can also have an IO-related dashboard with IOPS and network-related. Again, the same template can be used. Or I think that you might be more interested in the DBMS-related dashboard. So again, we use a templated dashboard, and we have one more selector, which is database, and you can have a finer view whether it be at the cluster level, host level, or database level. So if I want to see only the database ABC on the cluster 27, I just need to select it, and I will see the number of select, insert, update, delete, connection, and so on, directly in the dashboard. And here we can see that we have a cron somewhere because we have the spike on the rollback. So this is interesting. And let me tell you one thing, it's Grafana is beautiful. So if Grafana is so beautiful and so powerful, why not using it more? Because I don't know if you remember, but the Graylog dashboard are not as pretty as Grafana. So what we have done is we have connected Grafana to our log backend to use it. That's simple. At the data source, and you will be able to exploit your logs directly in Grafana. So that's one less UI that our developer need to bookmark and need to use. So what we have done, again, templated dashboard, the name of the database, the name of the application, we have in the log, we are able to extract the application name. So if our developer set the application name in the connection string, they can have a look directly at which application is responsible for a slow query. We have a top five of the number of slow queries per database, per application. We can see the error, the slow query, the cumulative time that we lost waiting for the result of our slow query. That's something that Graylog is not able to do. And we have also the deadlocks and so on. And with Grafana, we are able to spot bugs. Here, we are graphing the number of kill connections per database. So why this is important? Because we can see somewhere here that our developers have introduced a bug in the management of their connection pool. And this is useful because with the date, they can go back to the commit and see what's wrong with the commit. And we can see that they have introduced not one, but two bugs. So this is useful for them. But we can spot bugs, but we can also spot fix. So this is nice. We can spot fix at the application level, database level, cluster level. From our point, we are looking at the cluster level. If we need to dig at the database or the application level, we can do it. I know that you have already read something about the use method where you are supposed to collect and graph the utilization, saturation, error about each and every resources, the RED method where you are graphing the rate, the error, and the duration, or even the four golden signals. But that's not what I want to say. This is just the beginning. What I want to say is what we have done after this part. And what we have done is to use the Pareto method. We have focused on a tiny part of our databases. So as I was saying at the beginning, we have 400 databases. Obviously, we won't be able to fix all of them overnight. So we focus on only the top five worst databases. Worst in error, slow query, deadlock, and so on. And by fixing only those, we will be able to improve our workload. So let me tell you how we did it. And we have made some mistakes. So you can try. Maybe it will work for you. But I'm pretty sure that the first one will not work. What we have done with our graphs is we have taken every slow query and opened a ticket for each team and say, now it's time to fix. Please fix. They were not very happy because now the sprint is completely wrong. They have a backlog that can be huge, and they did not really appreciate the our effort because it's not very empathetic. Show of empathy for them. So we tried a second method. And again, I don't think this one will work for you. Because what we have done, maybe I don't need to explain this one. What we have done is we have said, your database is shit. Please fix. Obviously, that didn't work. So in our last effort, we have found a more efficient method, if I can say. But again, this one will not work. So don't bother. we prevent them from altering the database until they have fixed everything that we have reported. So now they were not able to push out new features. So they were pissed, the product owner were pissed, the product manager were pissed, the manager were pissed, and the manager of their manager of their manager were pissed. He goes to see my manager, which was pissed, which came to see me, and then I was pissed. So please don't do that. Maybe the last one will work if you are mindful of your colleagues and if you explain the process that you want to set up. So you just have to be nicer. Because I was nice in the three first steps, but not nice enough. So what I've done is I wanted to make it fun for the developer to fix and improve their workload. So I turned it into a game. Fun, interesting. And we were missing a tiny piece to conclude this process, and it was, you have probably guessed, we are missing a leaderboard. So to build the leaderboard, we have the logs, we have the metrics, we have Grafana. They know where Grafana is. We just need to build a leaderboard based on the database, the top five slowest databases, the top five databases where which produce the more deadlocks. And here we can see that we only need to focus on one database because they produces 22,000 slow query deadlocks per week. So we only need to fix this one. And the second one is only 35. So 35, we can live with that. But 22,000, we cannot. But we have the logs, we have the metrics, we have the leaderboard. But if the developer doesn't go read the leaderboard and take action, our efforts are useless. So what we have done next is to craft a weekly mail when we sum up the dashboard. Here is the link to the documentation. Here is the link where you can send us an email. Here is how you can get in touch with us if you need help, and a small TLDR. Congrats on the guys that fixed something during the last 7 days, and the bad guys. Don't target too many people at the same time, probably one or two. You are the bad guy of this week. The other, you are doing great. I come see you next week. And there is something missing. You can do this once, but you have to engage regularly your developers. Again and again, be relentless because they will get tired sometime. So that's why you need to congratulate them on their effort, but you must not stop. We are now about 1 year and a half later, and what I can tell you is this whole setup that I show you in the beginning take less than 1 week to set up. And of course, it's not free. You have to pay for the metrics, the series that you push, the logs that you store, but it's cheaper that way rather than to throw new hardware, new or more powerful hardware to fix a software problem. This will not work because a bad application will always consume more than a good application. I was talking at the beginning about PgBadger and PtQueryDigest. Our developer doesn't use it because they have Grafana now. And Grafana is much more efficient than PgBadger. So we have discontinued 2 weeks ago the PgBadger and PtQueryDigest reporting tool. And as I am talking about tools, you must choose the right one for the job. Grafana is extremely powerful to make dashboard and mix and match sources. So we have exposed our sources of logs and metrics to everyone in the company. So they can create a dashboard where they have the logs and metrics of their application and just aside the logs and metrics of their databases in the same dashboard. They don't need to switch tab to connect to a different UI. No, this is simple for them. And you can also give them the link directly to Greylog so they can dig into their logs. This is useful because the Greylog provide one URL for each and every log, so they can attach this URL in their bug tracker, their ticket issues or whatever, so everyone can see what you are talking about. And we have inspired others to do the same things. So now we have container reporting, we have API reporting, we have database, obviously, reporting. And with all those efforts from my beloved developer, we have divided by 4 the number of slow query. And the management is happy because they have KPIs now. But we are far from finished. What's next? The easy part is done. Where we needed an index we're missing, we have added. Where the database needed to be cleaned, we have cleaned. We need to go deeper if we want to improve even more our workload. So we need to engage at an higher level, spoke directly to the management. At first, we are talking tech to tech, but now we need to involve the management to prioritize the fixing of the workload. You got to help everyone go to the correct direction. Have the documentation ready, have the chat room, Cisco, WebEx, Team, whatever you use, Slack, to help them and be there for them, because it's hard for them. So if they don't get help, they will not fix it. And now we have a DBA team. We can help each team in the company refactor their app and redesign their schema. With those log and metrics, we want also to improve our monitoring, have metric-based notification, and we want to feed those data to machine learning to see what we can do with it. Maybe we will be able to identify affinity between databases, or we can have prediction about a database about to get slammed or whatever. And we want to automate as much as possible, starting with the indexes recommendation. There is a good blog post from the Percona blog where they explain how to identify and recommend a missing index in your databases. So what you need? You need the schema, you need some data, and you need a slow query. We have the slow query, we have all of them. So we just need to piece them together, scramble a bit, and see if we miss an index. This is based on pgqlstat and hypopg. So the evolution looks like this. We get rid of the reporting tool, and we connect machine learning to metrics and logs. And the DBA team is nowhere in the process because our developer is now autonomous. OK. This is about what I have to say. Just one thing. Someone have an idea about why this query is slow? Yes?
So there's an underscore at the beginning.
Yep.
So the can't use a B-tree index.
Yep.
Because the underscore is a wildcard.
Yep. That's it. That's a real production issue that we have. So what you said is that the underscore is like a single car wildcard. So basically, this query has to go through the whole table to find the answer. And finally, if those challenging interest you, we are hiring open source DBA, and a lot more of posts are available. And I will take time to answer your questions. Thank you. No, Grafana has an Elasticsearch plugin. I need to repeat the question. The question was, how do we visualize logs in Grafana? So Grafana has an Elasticsearch plugin, so you just need to define a data source Elasticsearch type and credential, and now you have access to your logs in Grafana. We can also use Kibana or Greylog. We have them, but everyone uses Grafana, so we put them in Grafana. Okay, thank you.